over 50 years, the Peanuts Gang has been entertaining the world, bringing smiles to the faces of both the young and the young at heart.
Fly, Charlie Brown, fly! Oh, you blockhead! Oh! We lost the game because of Charlie Brown!
From the football that never gets kicked by Charlie Brown, to the unrequited love that Lucy feels towards the man of her dreams, to the security blanket that's never far from Linus. The experiences of the Peanuts Gang are based on the life of the character's creator, Charles Schulz.
When I started the comic strip back in 1950, I wasn't thinking of animation. Television itself was just beginning. So it's interesting to me to see how the characters first developed on the comic page and then how they evolved on television.
I guess I've drawn this round head over 50,000 times now. Many of the struggles that Charlie Brown has gone through are similar to the struggles that I suffered when I was growing up. Struggles, in fact, that we all endure each day of our lives.
People always ask me if Charlie Brown will ever kick that football, if he'll ever fly that kite, if he'll ever win that baseball game. I kind of doubt it, but you never know.
It's the last frame. All I need is 5 pins. I can do it. I know I can do it. Just don't get nervous now. Don't panic. Take it easy.
Chuck, you're facing the wrong way. Don't throw it, Chuck. Stop. Stop.
Do it, ball. Please, do it. Did I do it? Did I get a strike? Did I win?
You threw the ball at the front door, Chuck.
I remember my mother saying once that if we ever had another dog, Snoopy would be a good name for the dog, which is why Snoopy is called by that name. And he was patterned a little bit after a dog that I had when I was about 13, 14 years old. His name was Spike, of course. He was kind of a wild dog. And Snoopy, when he started off, was just a cute little puppy, looked a little bit like Spike. But then as the years went on, he got up on his hind legs and he began to do all sorts of strange things, including thinking, which I don't think any of the other dogs in comic strips had ever done up until then.
Joe Cool, making rounds, checking all the kitties up and down. Joe Cool, play it straight. If the principal catches you, it's gonna be too late.
When the strip began, there were just Charlie Brown, Snoopy, and a few minor characters. But in January of 1952, Lucy Van Pelt joined the group. She represented all the fuss budgets in the world. She also was the perfect antagonist for poor old Charlie Brown.
Come on, Charlie Brown. It's almost midnight. I'll pour you a root beer.
Thank you, Lucy. I've decided next year I'm going to be a changed person.
Oh, be serious, Charlie Brown.
No, I mean it. I'm going to be strong and firm.
Forget it, Charlie Brown. You'll always be wishy-washy.
A few months after we introduced Lucy, again back in 1952, in the same way that my own family was growing, I thought Lucy should have a brother. That's how Linus joined us. The security blanket idea really worked well in the strip. In fact, it's perhaps the theme of which I'm most proud. In animation, we could take the whole blanket thing into wild action.
Smart with that blanket. What are you gonna do with it when you grow up?
Maybe I'll make it into a sport coat.
7 years later, in 1960, it was time to have a baby sister for Charlie Brown. Sally was a character who would speak out freely about all the pressures I think we put on little kids.
Who is the father of Henry IV? I could not possibly care less.
Oops, I'm sorry.
From 1960 to 1969, no new major characters were brought into the strip. In the late 60s, however, there were a lot of cultural changes taking place in this country. I felt that I needed to reflect those changes in the comic strip and on television. So our first major addition was a girl named Peppermint Patty. She was a sort of independent girl, living with a single parent who had the audacity to wear sandals.
Have you seen our baseball schedule for the new season, Chuck? My team plays your team 12 times. We slaughter you twice in April, smash you three times in May, ruin you twice in June, murder you three times in July, annihilate you four times in August, and destroy you all together in September.
My stomach hurts.
Peppermint Patty was soon joined by a younger friend called Marcy. She was more intelligent, sensitive, and polite than her older tomboy friend Patty, who she insisted on calling Sir.
I got the egg, sir, just like you asked.
Great! Come on in, Marcy. But please quit calling me Sir.
By 1970, everyone had a close friend except Snoopy. So we introduced Woodstock, named after the famous music festival. Our resident musician all these years has been Schroeder. He somehow manages to play everything from Beethoven to jazz on his toy piano.
Please don't set your lemonade on my piano. The glass might leave a ring.
Ooh, aren't we fussy, fussy, fussy?
I rarely draw the character Pigpen in the comic strip. Yet, for some reason, people are always asking me about him.
Bow to your left, bow to your right, and if you find no one in sight, just bow to your toes and bow to your knees and dance around just as you please.
When you're doing the Pigpen hoedown, gotta have a collar you can trust. Cause when Pigpen does the hoedown, he really kicks up some dust.
When I was a little kid, and we'd gather together and go out to play either tackle or touch football, it never failed that as the game started, we would begin with the kickoff. The person who was going to do the kicking would go running up to kick the ball, and the person holding the ball invariably would pull it away, and everybody would laugh. This just became something that that always happened. So why not do it in the comic strip? And who better to have pull it away than Lucy, and who could be better at being the one who has to suffer as Charlie Brown?
You know, I wonder if there isn't something symbolic in this. There has to be. You hold the ball like I'm running up to kick it, and then you pull it away. There has to be something deeply symbolic in that. I've thought about it and thought about it. Somehow, though, I've missed the symbolism. Oh, no! You also missed the ball, Charlie Brown.
It really isn't a holiday without Charlie Brown and his friends. Charles Schulz developed seven holiday specials featuring the Peanuts gang.
The first show that was animated was the Christmas show back in 1965.
We were surprised by the strong national reaction this first show achieved. Apart from its strong statements about the Christmas season, I think the unusual jazz score by Vince Guaraldi was one of the reasons for the show's success. With the success of the Christmas show, we decided to stick with the holiday themes. I had started the idea of the Great Pumpkin in the strip, and then animation was able to bring the whole idea to a different dimension.
If anyone had told me I'd be waiting in a pumpkin patch on Halloween night, I'd have said they were crazy.
I got five pieces of candy. I got a chocolate bar.
I got a quarter.
I got a rock.
That scene with the rock seemed to get a lot of viewers. Charlie Brown received candy and cookies from folks all over the United States. And after our Valentine's special, he again got Valentines from concerned children all across the country. When planning the Thanksgiving special, I was thinking about the traditional food served at this holiday. I wondered what kind of a Thanksgiving meal Snoopy might prepare for all the kids for their Thanksgiving. Rounding out our major holidays, I thought it might be fun if the Easter Beagle would take over from the Easter Bunny. This was a lot of fun for Snoopy because he got to dance with some of his all-time favorites, the Bunny Wunnies.
In addition to these holidays, Charles Schulz also created specials for New Year's and Arbor Day. In each, Charlie Brown not only entertains, but also teaches and educates us. and that was always the most important goal of Charles Schulz.
I think Charlie Brown just wants to be left alone to enjoy the things in life that he really likes. I've always said that he's probably the sort of little kid that I would have liked to have had as a friend or a neighbor when I was small, because he likes these simple things in life. He likes baseball and he likes to read. He doesn't want to bother anybody else. He just wants to enjoy these things that he likes and not be interrupted by other more nasty people who have a tendency to want to spoil the things that you like. But Charlie Brown's a very decent, caring little boy. Unfortunately, he is surrounded by people who don't have any idea what's going on, and by a dog who doesn't even remember his name.
The magic, the mayhem, and the mischief of Charlie Brown, Snoopy, Lucy, and the entire Peanuts gang will continue entertaining the world for generations to come, thanks to their unforgettable creator, Charles Schulz.